Hello everyone. In this video I'm going to describe the physics of the main functionalities of Rayleigh scattering. Now Rayleigh scattering is scattering that occurs when we scatter light from small particles. And of course you should immediately ask, well, what do we mean by small particles? And the way to answer a question like that is to look at the length scales of the problem. We have particle size, but we also have the wavelength of light. So Rayleigh scattering is for particles that are small compared to the wavelength of light. And I'll write lambda as the wavelength of light. So let me draw a wave, some wave crest here, propagating in this direction. Let's draw a particle. I'm going to draw an arbitrary shape for a particle. And because the particle is small compared to the wavelength of light, the wave totally fills the particle, unimpeded, and the electrons in that particle respond to the electromagnetic field of the wave, actually the electric part of the electromagnetic wave, and get to oscillating, and that oscillation re-radiates radiation in all directions. Now to figure out what's happening for the total particle, we need to divide this total particle up into a bunch of small subvolumes, the method of calculus essentially. One way I could draw a subvolume is just as a little dot here, okay? Might label it some dV. Add up all these dVs, we get the total volume of the particle. Now the wave will come in, hit this subvolume, there's a bunch of electrons in there, they get oscillating, re-radiate a wave, and looking at the symmetry of very small things, the symmetry is essentially spherical. So the re-radiated wave will be spherical as well. This is really very analogous to the idea of taking a pebble and dropping it into a pond of water. Boom, it hits the pond surface, circular waves come emanating out. Now another thing I'm going to do when I draw these spherical waves emanating out from that small subvolume is I'm going to ignore polarization effects. That's certainly an important effect, but one thing at a time. We don't want to chew gum and walk at the same time. So let's just ignore polarization. So here comes this wave, it hits this spot here, and the wave propagates out with a nice spherical symmetry into the far field. Now I'm going to put a detector way down here, very far away. I think that's how you spell detector. And it could be a meter away, it could be miles away, or it could be an inch away, but certainly large distance compared to the wavelength of light. And so I've got from this small subvolume here, waves propagating in that direction. Now, obviously I want to sum up the waves from all kinds of subvolumes. I'll draw a second subvolume just for fun. So here's dV2, maybe that's dV1 and so on. But now a very, very important point is, again, because this particle's extent, its size, is so small compared to the wavelength of light, all these subvolumes see light of the same phase. And with that, that means all the electrons in these subvolumes are oscillating in phase, not out of sync, but in sync in the same phase. So we have the same phase for all these point emitters. So this guy, again, sends a beam out. We'll send it off parallel. These parallel waves meet, of course, at infinity, where the detector is in the far field. So we've got in-phase emissions, in-phase scatterings from these subvolumes. But the second thing that happens, while it propagates out to the detector, again based on the fact that the particle is small compared to the wavelength of light, is that they end up in phase at the detector as well. There's no phase difference accrued due to the slightly different distances that they have to travel because those slightly different distances are small compared to the wavelength of light. Now that's an extremely important point, and we definitely want to write that down. We'll say that the waves at the detector are in phase. Given that, when we add up all the different point emitters here that comprise the total particle with their waves out here, we basically just get that the total scattered field out of the detector, and I'll let E be my amplitude, right, for the electric field of the wave, is proportional to the number of these subvolumes times the amplitude of the incident wave. Now I ask you, if I'm going to divide this thing up into a number of subvolumes, what's the number of subvolumes n proportional to with regard to the size of the particle? And the answer is the volume. So I take this one step further and I write that the total scattered field at the detector is proportional to the volume of the particle times the incident field wave. Let's go to the second board. So let's think about that. You'll recall in a former video that we made, we talked about the properties of waves and light in particular. And we found that the intensity, the power that's transmitted in a wave, is proportional to the field squared. So I'll write I, as a reminder, is proportional to the field squared. That tells us that the scattered radiation from my particle over there, my Rayleigh particle, is proportional to this total field that I wrote down squared. And of course, just following through, I get the volume of the particle squared times the incident field squared, which continuing is the volume of the particle squared times the incident intensity. Now, that's really a very remarkable result. Look at that. We've got that the scattered light intensity is proportional to the volume of the particle squared. Very strong dependency. I mean, think in terms of spheres. The volume of a sphere is proportional to its radius cubed. This would imply a radius to the sixth power, an extremely strong proportionality. Now, the last thing I want to do is consider the overall scattering, which is the cross-section for scattering. And that's another topic we talked about in an earlier video. And you recall, cross-section, conceptually, is an area. For instance, I hold my hand out in the falling rain, and the cross-section for the rain hitting my hand is essentially the area of my hand. And of course, I can change that area if I change the tilt of my hand. So scattering of radiation is proportional to the scattering cross-section times the incident radiation. Now, had I been a little more clever at the whiteboard, I would have written this over here. But let's do compare this term to this term. And the two combined together imply that we've got a scattering cross-section that's proportional to the volume squared. And we'll just box that up just a little bit. Fine. But now we've got an even bigger problem. The units are wrong. What are the units of scattering cross-section? Well, the units are centimeters squared, right? An area. Length squared, if you want to say. What are the units of volume squared? Well, they're centimeters to the sixth power, or a length to the sixth power. We've got a problem. The units have to work out. What can rescue us from this problem? Is there another length scale in the system besides the size of the particle that can pull this sixth power down to a squared power? And there is. That's how we started the whole thing. These particles are small. Small compared to what? The wavelength of light. The wavelength of light is our other length scale. And so, based on a dimensionality argument, we're going to conclude that Rayleigh scattering has a cross-section that's proportional to the volume of the particle squared divided by the wavelength to the fourth power. And that is the functionality of Rayleigh scattering. Now, there's a lot of really cool consequences for this, but we're going to talk about that in the next video.